I've seen that. I think a nun ought to have, if she's going to show her legs, they ought to be attractive.
This is a Marilyn Monroe kind of photo, isn't it?
What?
Well, look what happens to the...
Yeah, it was over the. It was over a subway area, yeah. and the wind came up.
Higher, you were thinking. Show me everything.
No, I wasn't. I really wasn't. I thought it was. I was grateful for what it was. This is a shirt. There was. That's all I can say. It's my shirt picture. This is my friend, Richard Pusadort, who I think is a great artist. He's one of the second generation abstract expressionists. I got to know Richard, and Richard was doing, that's when I began. It was during the time I knew Richard that I began to think of photography as possibly a way of earning a living. And Richard did many different things. Aside from his paintings, he fixed watches and he fixed clocks, and he did all, and aside from which, he was also a funny, amusing man. I have always thought that it's kind of nice if someone is a good or great artist that he not necessarily be an unpleasant person.
Have you met many of those?
Well, you know, someone like Dylan, when you see an interview with him, you ask yourself, why is he so, there's something, I'm not picking on him, he is obviously a great and unusual figure in a certain world, but I watched a three-part interview with him, and he was just resentful and angry and unpleasant. Now, here's a man who's probably very, very rich, and has been admired by many, many people. And what is the reason for conveying, maybe I'm being unfair, maybe it's his idea of being cheerful.
You didn't like it?
No, I was mystified by it. You know, I am mystified sometimes by people, and there is such a thing as being, there is a problem, there's a whole world of very successful people who are dissatisfied or convey certain notions of dissatisfaction.
I thought you said in New York when I interviewed you that fame isn't necessarily breeding very nice people, or it's
It's sometimes there are people who are very successful and they're very fortunate and they have many of the nice things in life, and yet they are dissatisfied. There are people who have a talent for dissatisfaction, and there are people who have a talent for being unpleasant.
You're not one of them.
Well, I have to be forgiven for not always being in the best frame of mind and occasionally dipping into depression. I am sometimes capable of being depressed. Even I can tell myself, what are you depressed about? You're having a show in Hamburg. You're having a show in Amsterdam.
You should be happy.
You should be happy. Sometimes I am. But having two shows is not...
The birds are coming out. That's a telephone, I think.
What?
Oh, were you listening to the sound or not?
No. Yeah. This is Eugene Smith.
Having two shows is not... Well, finish yourself.
No, I don't think that having... there's something... Let's put it this way. You have to divide... Some people think that if you have certain things, you're a photographer. Look, there are photographers who are never satisfied. They need show after show after show. They're not satisfied with one show, just as there are people who need more and more money, more and more this, more and more that, more and more everything. That doesn't make you happy necessarily. And but you can't tell people that, because if someone is if someone is a maniac, there's not too much you can do. If someone is greedy, and there's not too much you can do.
Right.
You asked me before if I truly am not jealous of others. I admire too many people, and I've never allowed the fact that there are some people in the world who hate success. I don't hate success, but I don't think that in itself it gets rid of everything else, you know?
Yeah. Let's open up this room for questions. If anybody wants to ask a question, please stand up and...
Is that it, Margaret?
You have some... You want to continue first and then do the questions?
Okay. This is Barbara, with whom I lived for a number of years. Barbara was unhappy about... I'm allowed to say this now because she's no longer among the living. She was always talking about getting a breast reduction, which I didn't feel was necessary. This is a model whom I photographed for Harper's Bazaar. And this is Carmen, who thought I was crazy because there were a number of mirrors in the room, and I would shoot sometimes with my back to her, and she wondered what was going on, and she thought the whole thing was very weird. She happens to be the oldest, she's still modeling now. I don't know, she must be in her 80s or late. She's still very beautiful. It's quite remarkable.
Have you seen her in real
life? I haven't seen her. I've seen photographs of her where she looks terribly good. So, and this is, that's between boards. I'm ashamed to say it's what they call, isn't that what they call a signature photograph? Maybe.
Did you choose it, or did Howard choose the iconic photograph?
Howard sometimes notices things that I overlook.
Is he right?
Yes, he's quite often right.
Okay.
Yeah, he is right. This is Faye, who was the sister of... She was the sister of a girl that I was a little bit, or more than a little bit, or maybe not in love with. Faye was a daughter of a rabbi. And although her behavior was not would not be considered proper in the rabbinical world, her father was a rabbi and a very fine scholar. And Faye was interested in psychology. And many years later, I met her I was with Soames, and I met her in the Morgan Library, and she was wearing a long fur coat, which Soames didn't approve of, because Soames had she was an anti-fur person. And Faye was trying to talk to me, and her husband was over there and kept screaming at her, "Let's go." And I thought that was not very gracious behavior on the part of a man who was a psychoanalyst on Park Avenue. I thought it was not very nice. Mm. This is a picture. I remember there was Klein's. I don't know if anyone remembered. Oh, you probably not. No one knows who Klein's. Klein's was a store where they sold things that were marked down. And one day it was snowing, and I took that picture. This is my father, who would be outraged that I'm showing him here. I think my sister was schizophrenic, and my father and I were going to a doctor. And even though he looks happy, this is a perfect example of a photograph, which is a complete lie, because even though he looks happy, he was very unhappy because of my sister and her illness. This is my sister at my aunt's house, covering up her face. This is a window in the basement of my mother's house. My mother dreamed of decorating certain places, and she failed. But she had the fantasy. This is one of my painted photographs. Painting photographs was something that I would not have approved of at one point. And this is another one. This is a young girl who was, I think, 16 or 17, and she was involved with a man who was much older, and she ended up becoming an Orthodox Jew and became very observant. This is the same photograph as the one, this one, the painting is the same one as the other one.
Yeah.
And this is a very early painting of mine of a kind of abstract figure. And this is another one. These are from, I was in, I believe, my 20s, early 20s. And this is one of my abstractions, which sometimes resembles a landscape. Or I don't mind, some abstract artists dislike the idea of comparing their work to something realistic. I don't mind if someone sees a landscape in an abstract. This is a kind of picture of my sister. I occasionally make little sketches and I call them this one's my sister, even though I'm not sure that it is my sister. But something about is my sister. This is a rabbinical, this is a little rabbi painting, although. And this is a picture I did, a very early picture, which I believe occasionally someone likes. I am a dark figure. There's a camera, and that man is I think he was selling flowers. Is that it?
Okay. Shall we face the audience here?
Yeah.
Questions. Please stand up and ask your question. And first question is always the most difficult one. Or do you have one?
Oh, here you go.
Yeah. It's a very shy audience, Saul.
Yeah.
In Amsterdam. Yeah. No, not really.
Thank you. Hi, yes, I'm also a New Yorker, and I was wondering your perspective. People complain that New York has lost its edge, that it's become very sweet and gentrified and commercial. Does that make it less interesting to photograph?
I don't understand what you said.
The question is that some people say that New York has lost its edge.
What does that mean?
Well, maybe in the period that you were photographing, it was a little grittier, a little more authentic, not so many chain stores, etc. Beautiful buildings everywhere.
Some people would say that, I mean, Manhattan, for example, is taken over by yuppies, by people who have too much money and who are taking out maybe the soul of the city or the stuff that you could photograph.
No, I think that there are respectable a number of people who are not rich. I don't know what it means. There is a notion that maybe America is in a decline. I think that's a very good thing. I think that maybe if America graciously accepts the fact that it's in a decline, maybe they'll be better off. Maybe they'll avoid doing things like going into Iraq or going into Afghanistan. Maybe the idea of sending 5,000 people to be killed in a war is not a very good idea.
And to get back to the question, the photographs that you made 30, 40 years ago, could you make them today as well? Is it still a good city to work in as a photographer?
I think so. I think that if someone wanted to, there may be more than just someone. You know, photography is not about, I've said this and I recently have been quoted, photography is not, it's not about what something is or where it is. It's about what you do with it. It's about how you see it. It's about, there may be, and I'm not, I can't predict the tendencies in the world of art that exist today. There obviously are people exploring certain areas. So, do I think it's impossible to take certain kinds of pictures in New York now? I do think you can do it if you want to do it.
Yeah. Okay, next one. They're all afraid that they're making this into an interview, I think.
Maybe that's it.
No questions? Oh, I've heard it all. To conclude this, I mean, you were saying we have two shows, or you have two shows now in Amsterdam and in Hamburg.
Yeah.
And you were talking about, does that make me happy? Sometimes I'm depressed. Does it make you happy that it's also picked up now here and people are very enthusiastic about your work? That's what I heard in Amsterdam.
I simply am trying to say that if you suffer occasionally from depression, and depression is not always logical, that one can be depressed and at the same time very pleased and grateful with some of the nice things that happen. Now that may sound like a contradiction, that while you're depressed, you're happy, but it's possible.
Is that your present state of mind? Or
Sometimes.
Sometimes.
Sometimes, yeah. You know. Sometimes. I mean, just because someone has something that he or she wants doesn't mean that there are not moments when other feelings intrude. So, if you want to lie, you can say that never happens. There are people who like to lie and pretend there's a kind of coherent structure to one's emotional life, but it isn't. There are contradictions, and there are moments when things clash with each other, and there are times when you know that reason isn't the only thing that operates in the life, in our mishmashy life.
Yeah, right. Last question, you brought your camera. I was just thinking, that's what I was trying to tell you, that for us here in Amsterdam, it's quite special that people are skating now on the canals, because we haven't seen that.
I haven't seen them skating on the canal, and I like the idea of their skating on the canal. And I remember, there's a very famous, I'm not sure whether he's Dutch. There is an artist who did a lot of beautiful paintings of people skating on.
Lots of it is from here. Anybody was mentioning the name or not? Bruegel. Bruegel, do you mean that painter? Bruegel, we call him. Bruegel? I don't know, how does it translate in English?
I think his name was something like Afrikaamp. Yeah. Is there an Afrikaamp?
Yeah? Okay.
And I think I'm not an authority on Dutch painting, but I remember
work of him.
Skaters. And I like the idea of, there's a very famous painting of a man skating. It's a portrait.
In Edinburgh.
Who?
In Edinburgh, in the National Gallery. The Reverend Skater.
The Reverend Skater? Well, that's what I mean. That particular. What?
What did you say?
Scotland.
It's in Scotland. Yeah, you're talking about the same picture.
Yeah. It's a kind of portrait, and yet there's something funny about the fact that this person is a reverend, a religious figure who's skating. Religious people are not supposed to skate. Religious people are supposed to be immersed in tragic communion with God against the dark background.
You were so not meant to be a rabbi, that's clear from the start. Well, on that note, thank you so much for being here. And I hope that you get a chance, because you brought your camera,
to see the skaters.
Yeah, to get the skating rabbi in Amsterdam on a canal. Thank you so much. Saul Leiter.